wait and see. For the moment, it's an important discussion that we have lined up for you. A report from rating agency Crystal indicates that about 75% of the companies that availed of moratorium may be low-rated companies and mostly mid-sized businesses. Another report from ICRA indicates that 5 to 8% of total bank loans may need to be restructured. Everyone's wanting to know how the moratorium or the post-moratorium period will play out, and hence we have the authors of both these reports with us. Joining us is Subodh Rai, Senior Director, Crystal Ratings, and Karthik Srinivasan, Group Head Financial Sector Ratings at ICRA. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us. Subodh, to you first. This is only corporate sector, right? Your reference, your study that 75% are sub-investment rating, 75% of those who availed of moratorium are sub-investment rating refers only to corporate, not to retail, right?
Yes.
Okay. So what's your sense about how much this may harm the banking sector's asset quality 2 years down the line? Will most of the 75% be defaulters?
So I think it is difficult to answer this question. I will tell you why it is, and let me just explain. If you look at these companies, and we did a study of our entire portfolio, we have around 9,000 companies where ratings are standing. And 2,300 companies, slightly more than that, have taken moratorium. And as you rightly said, 75% of these companies are in sub-investment grade, first taken moratorium. Now, when it comes to slippages, there's two, three things I wanted to highlight. There are companies who are having stable business model, they have a decent liquidity, but they also took moratorium because they wanted to conserve liquidity to meet any contingency.
Yeah.
So, then there are companies who sort of opted for moratorium because they had a genuine need. So, essentially, the second bunch of companies where you may see some slippages, but then there is a catch. RBI has just announced debt restructuring. And finally, we have to see how many of these companies eventually opt for debt restructuring, how many of these companies actually get debt restructuring from bank. And then we'll get a final picture that what will the slippages. You know, moratorium has just gotten over, so we are keeping a track of collection. And hopefully in 2-3 months time, we'll get a relatively clear picture that from where the stress will come. At this juncture, there's a lot of moving part and difficult to say what part of this will be a slippage actually.
Okay. In fact, Karthik Srinivasan is also with us, so let's get a sense from him. Karthik, you know, Subodh is making a point, right? I mean, it's too soon perhaps to gauge what percentage of these low-rated companies would result in delinquencies. But what does your number crunching indicate?
I agree that it's a bit early, but we also need to factor in another point. Unlike in the past where restructuring was allowed for even stressed entities, this time RBI is pretty clear that the restructuring would be allowed only for entities which are not more than 30 DPD due. In other words, SMA 1 and 2 are not eligible for restructuring. As per the RBI data, it's about 6% odd of the credit is under SMA 1 or 2. If we were to look at various numbers shared by banks and NBFCs over the last month and a half, the moratorium numbers varies anywhere between 8-9% at one end to about 40-45% on the other end. Our assessment is at a system level, possibly the weighted average moratorium would be in the vicinity of about 20-25%, may have come down as we speak today, number one. Number two, SMA 1 and 2 are not allowed restructuring, so that again clearly moves out about 5-6% of the portfolio. And as Subodh also articulated, you know, some of the stronger entities have also opted for restructuring. Opted for moratorium to conserve cash. So factoring in all those, we believe that the overall restructuring quantum can be lower, but the actual extent we would only come to know in a couple of months' time.
No, I take that point. So I have too many questions. Subodh, first of all, when you say some people would have had money, but they anyway took the moratorium for comfort, they would not be in the sub-investment grade, would they? In your sub-investment grade, which you say is 3/4 of the moratorium demanding guys, what is the amount of money you are speaking about? And over there, they are already sub-investment, and the debt that is going to come is going to be an additional debt because it's going to be interest on interest, which will pan out. So what is the strike rate? So I want the total amount of money we are talking about. Are we talking about 50,000 crore, 60,000, 1 lakh crore? And in that, how many will be able to bear a higher debt burden?
I think let me give you a flavor on sub-emission grade. That are first, there are many companies are in sub-emission grade because probably their turnover may not be very high. They may be operating in a single segment, in single geography. But there are several companies which has fairly stable business model operating since last 15, 20 years. So it's not as if these companies are on brink of default before they took moratorium. Yes, they operate with lesser liquidity cushion, and that's the reason to tide over this COVID-induced slowdown, many of them in moratorium. In terms of amount of rated debt, average borrowing size for these companies is around 25 to 30 crore. It's not very large borrowing. So the quantum, if you ask me, is not going to be pretty high.
Oh, okay.
Though the number of companies will be very high. In fact, we also conducted a similar study what Karthik had just spoken about before debt restructuring was announced. And our estimate was also similar, that probably, you know, around 6% of the exposure will be at risk.
Okay, but can you tell me that number? I mean, I know you said that their average borrowing is 25-30 crore. So are we talking about 20,000 crore of troubled borrowers?
So if you look at that number and, overall, and I'm not linking it in moratorium now, I'm linking this with debt at risk because these are two separate studies. From debt at risk perspective, this number will be close to 1.5 lakh crore.
Okay.
But just keep one thing in mind, that this is a rated debt. And there's a difference between rated debt and outstanding debt, because a lot of companies take credit lines in their way and cash credit, which is not fully utilized. Mm-hmm. So the actual rated amount will be much lower.
Smaller.
Actually, I had a question for Karthik. We've been talking about the overall trend, but particularly for these sectors which have been highly impacted, whether it's gems and jewelry, hotels, automobile dealers, power, what is the percentage that have availed moratorium and what is the percentage that could default, you think?
No, it's a lot of entities in these stress sectors have opted for moratorium and moratorium 1 and 2. Some of them were already in SMA 1 and 2, so I'm not really they would obviously not get the benefit of restructuring. For others, how much would actually slip over 2 years would also depend on how well the structuring package is worked out for these entities. So while one definitely acknowledges the stress in most of these sectors that you just highlighted, but before jumping on to actual those accounts slipping into NPAs, I think we could probably wait for another week or two till we get clarity from the expert committee on parameters that they are setting and how the loans are actually restructured by the lenders.
Okay, we are absolutely heading to that. We have overshot the time limit of the show, but I have to get answers from both of you. You are both rating agencies who could be called upon to rate the restructured loan. So, Karthik, first to you, if you are called and when you are called, are you likely to ask people to take a higher provisioning now itself because, a company which is being faced with a higher debt may be less capable of paying it? So do you think we should expect banks to have a higher provisioning in the third quarter numbers?
We could expect banks to have slightly higher provisioning in Q2 as well as in Q3.
What about you, Subodh? If you're asked to rate a restructured debt, would you not pass any of them because they're not sustainable, or would you ask banks to provide more? How would you approach it?
So, obviously, we will not ask banks to provide for provisioning because that will be advisory and that is conflict. But in terms of expectation, we believe private banks who are very well capitalized. In fact, in the last 4 months, they have raised more than 15,000 crore of capital, and they are very better capitalized. They are the ones who will take probably higher provisioning to be on safer side. PSU banks are also reasonably well placed after capitalization of 2.7 lakh crores in last year. They may also do a little bit higher probably. So I agree with Karthik, in next two quarters you may see higher probably.
Okay. All right. We have lots more questions. Out of time, we'll continue this debate on another day. Thank you very much for watching Bazaar. Lot of trading ideas coming up for you on Chartbusters.